Hey guys, this is Matt.
This is Misha.
And we're here at the soft opening of the new Golden Lantern Coffee Roasters retail cafe here in Mission Viejo.
The challenge. Espresso is so addicting because it's to get a good espresso shot, every single part needs to be perfect, from all the way from like sourcing to rosy roasting it just right to your puck prep to everything. The extraction needs to be perfect, and if any one of those things is wrong, even at the end of the chain, it'll kind of mess it up. That's all it takes. Pour over is a bit more forgiving, which is great, but espresso is such a challenge, and then when you nail it, it's so satisfying. And when you have those one of those espresso shots, I feel like you could remember how that tastes for the rest of your life, and you're always like, kind of like, oh, how did I match up this time? So I fail a lot. I'm not great at making espresso, but I love the challenge. And then the few times when I get it, it's like, oh, it's the best feeling, and I want to see if I could capture that again. And then I love flat whites, and like the whole latte art side of it is a whole thing, which I have zero talent for. I'm just trying to brute force my way into learning how to do it better. And that's a fun challenge I know I'll be working on for the rest of my life. So I enjoy the art of it. I really do. There's a science that you kind of get your head around that people are still innovating in. And I'm you know, watching guys like Lance Hedrick and James Hoffman to learn the latest tricks and tips and whatever. And then there's the art of it, which is how do you apply it to make coffee that tastes good to you? And that's a very personal thing. And I feel like I'm always discovering, and I know I'll get to do that for the rest of my life. So very long answer, but that's my favorite thing about coffee.
Many times there's no like right or wrong answer when people say, you know, it's kind of like what you, I tell a lot of people, it's what you like. Well, how do you like it? You know,
well,
I can take
ask you the same question.
Right. I mean, and that's kind of the beauty, you know, we kind of look for, you know, take espresso. We look for kind of like this balance, and, you know, you might be looking for an espresso, you know, with your acidic components, your bitter, you might be looking for a natural sweetness. But anytime, you know, I'm kind of demoing a coffee with someone, I tell them, look, I can pull the same coffee that's in here. I can literally pull 100 shots and make them taste 100 different ways. What it comes down to is like, what I like is one thing and that's how we represent it, but if you're at home making coffee, it's whatever you like, you know? We're not here to tell you necessarily, we're here to guide you, we're not here to tell you that this is the end-all be-all answer, you know? So that's kind of a beautiful thing about it, is there's so many ways to apply it and so many ways to enjoy it that it's kind of open to you as the, you know, consumer to find out what you like and run with it. Pretty much, this was kind of like a passion project, like a lot of other, you know, ventures. You know, coffee was the ritual, especially on tour. That's kind of the first thing you do when you get to any new city is drop the bags and kind of go out in town. It kind of gives you a chance to see the city, see the culture. And coming from East Jersey at a time where, like, coffee wasn't really this culinary art, it was going places like Australia, New Zealand, Southeast Asia, South America, you know, Europe. And you really got this craft, you know, coffee experience that was more of like a, not only a cultural experience, but a culinary one as well. I fell in love with it thanks to a couple of people that I was touring with. You know, I kind of sent me down the rabbit hole, you know, from my time touring with Misha and Periphery. You know, that was kind of like our thing, was where to get the best coffee every day. And, you know, kind of went down the rabbit hole, became a garage roaster. And then COVID obviously kind of killed touring, killed live events. I was dicking around in the garage roasting coffee and sending bags to people for free, you know, literally in black Ziploc bags or whatever. And, you know, Misha was from the start one of the people that was like, hey, you know what? Like, this is getting better. You're onto something. You're kind of like, you know. So we said, let's kind of take a stab at this thing and see what we can do, you know. And here we are 4 years later.
Coming from the touring side, you know, like Rosie started out as a Periphery's merch guy. We all fell in love with him. Everyone falls in love with Rosie.
The truth is there's so many people doing fantastic things. A lot of it comes down to your traceability, your transparency. You know, are you working with great producers? Do you have a great importer? So yeah, it's not about anyone can go online and you can like get green coffee, but you might not know anything about that green coffee. And it is not all created equal. So it's really about doing your homework and figuring out that part. And then, you know, also figuring out the science and the art of roasting that to present it the way that you want to best represent it. So it's a rabbit hole for sure, and one that involves so many moving parts and so much intricacy.
Oh, they love it. They get supplied with free coffee on every tour. Our coffee games, like, we bring like pour over setups, like hand grinders. Like, everyone takes it pretty seriously now. It's one of those things that when you get exposed to it, it's like, oh wow, this is a different level.